we belong to them and remain accountable to them and draw from them as parents in our lives when we desperately don't know what to do. The Bible says, call a friend. And so we call in the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, but through the leadership, help us. And also, just to let you know that we remain accountable. We know Lone Rangers here. I don't glow in the dark. So if I start smoking good stuff and start preaching some rubbish, the elders can phone up John and Jane and say, listen, you best get on the plane here because Rod has left the reservation. So, and it's just a protection for you guys, and I want that because we all have feet of clay. Amen? And so we want to remain accountable. John, we're excited to hear the word of God through you today. And you're coming unwired there. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And if you'd allow me to pray for you, and if we would prepare our hearts, because the word of God transforms us. It doesn't change us, it transforms us from a worm to a butterfly, kind of that kind of transformation. Hallelujah. So Father, thank you. We thank you that your word is so rich, so sweet, so powerful, able to just to transform us and bring us into your likeness. And so Father, we just receive John and Jane as apostolic oversight in our house and our home. We release them with their gift. We open our hearts to hear what you're saying, that we may have ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. And so, Father, we are thankful, grateful people here in Flagler County. We give you praise for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, John.
Amen. Thanks, Rod. Well, it's always a great privilege to be here and to be part of this. As Rod said, it's like a second home for us in Florida. We're from South Africa. Those of you who don't know us, we live in Port Elizabeth, southernmost city of Africa, in fact. And then we travel most of our lives now looking after some 25 churches across the world, mainly in South Africa, but we have the three churches here in the United States, which we spent some time with. And all the elders got together for the first time. We gather the churches in what we call a cluster of churches, and so Jane and I have the privilege of overseeing that. We're also very involved in an organization called World Mission Center, and so we are involved, I'm particularly involved just with international planting of what we call live schools. It's a 242-hour training that takes someone with a very basic education through to being a church planter, aimed predominantly at unreached people groups. And next month I'm going to be joining a team in India. We completed the Hindi translation about 18 months ago, and we already have over 200 schools running in India, and we're aiming to get 800 schools in there. And it's the northeast of India is the most unreached area of the world. There are some 200 million people who've never heard the gospel in that region. So that's where it's all headed, and you're all part of that because it's part of what we do and part of what we link into from here. So thank you for loving us, and we love you guys. Always a joy to be here. I want to share with you just a message this morning on helping us in some way, and I hope it will help you to hear what the Lord speaks to us. I've just called it lessons in hearing. Some time back, as we were back in our own home church, our son Mark was preaching, and he stirred something in me, and I realized, as I had looked back over my own life, what a privilege it was to have learned how to hear the voice of God. And so I want to just share that with you this morning. Mark was just saying, you know, if God's going to change your purpose, so let's put your purpose out on that side. When you're living over here and you look to that side and understand that your purpose has changed, you need to understand that when God changes your purpose, your provision goes to where the purpose is. And so you have to change your position. You got to go from here to there. And, you know, it was a great message, but I'm sitting there thinking, okay, when you look back and you've now moved and got here, you can look back and say, oh, God told me. But when you're standing here, it's not always that easy, is it? Well, it hasn't been for me. It hasn't been for us. You'll always hear someone will tell you a story. You hear some great stories from preachers over the years, but you'll hear stories like, you know, I was driving down the road one day and I heard the audible voice of God, and he said to me, turn left here. And so I turned left, and as I turned left, I went down the road, and someone was on the side of the road waving, and I stopped, and he opened my window, and he passed me a check for $250,000, and it was just what I needed for the house that God had told us to buy. Praise the Lord. And I'm thinking, wow, where did you come from? I mean, I'm like, I just don't get that kind of, you know, I don't know about you, but maybe some of you here have had those experiences. We just never have. I'm kind of sitting here saying, God, is that you? Am I hearing what is going on? So if you're one of those, I'll share with you what I've experienced over the years. And you know, I that story, by the way, is not one I heard. I just made it up because I don't know anybody who's been on that level of understanding or hearing from God. But this is the thing I'm absolutely sure of. Are we going to get a PowerPoint up? Can we do that? Thank you. Because one thing I'm absolutely sure, as we hear God, it's His will that we should. So if we can pull up the next scripture, John 10, verse 27. God says very clear to us, these are the words of Jesus, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." And so the bottom line of it all is this: God does speak to us, and you do hear Him, and we will follow Him. Now, how we hear Him comes in many different ways. So I have no doubt in my mind, because I believe the scripture with all of my being, that we will hear God's voice. And if we lack wisdom, we can ask from Him, and He will tell us. Now, James 1 verse 5 says, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God, and He will give it to you. He'll not rebuke you for asking. The Message says it this way. It says, if you don't know what you're doing, and I don't know about you, there are many times in my life I don't know what I'm doing. If you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. You'll get His help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. So God's wanting us to know what we're supposed to do. He wants us to hear, and I believe with all, you know, in all integrity, I can say to you this morning, there is nothing in God that wants to withhold from you what He wants you to hear from Him. I want to share with you just some of the things, some of the lessons I've learned on the journey. His voice for me has never been audible. It's at times been much clearer, that still small voice that I've known, you know, very clearly when God has wanted to show me something particular. And normally I just sense. I somehow sense what He's saying. And so I'm more inclined to say, you know, I just sense the Lord saying this. Because once you start dealing with folks who say, God said this to me, it becomes a little difficult to disagree with that. and sometimes it's not absolutely clear. But, you know, God can guide us in many different ways. In Psalms, it actually says He'll guide us with His eye. Now, I'm not sure what that means, but I know I could guide my kids with my eye. If they were misbehaving and we had visitors, I'd just give them a look, and they'd get up and go and play outside. So you know, there's something in relationship that comes when, in the end, God can just, He can kind of look you in the eye spiritually, if you understand what I'm saying, and we get it. So I know He will speak to us in different ways. It's not just with physical ears, and I'm not denying this morning that sometimes God does speak to people in an audible voice. I'm not challenging people who've heard that. I just never have. I feel like a mere mortal in this thing, and I want to share with you, if you're a mere mortal with me, how do we check it out? How do we hear from God, and what is it that He's saying? So Matthew 11 verse 15, if we can go there, said, "He who has ears to hear," again the words of Jesus, "let him be listening. And let him consider and perceive and comprehend by hearing." So there's no doubt in my mind that God wants us to hear. And if we will open our spiritual ears, we will hear from Him. So my journey would go back probably some 50 years. I'm 66 now. At the age of 16, my dad died. I was at boarding school. And I realized at that point, I'd better learn to hear from God for my life, because up until that point, I'd just done what my dad told me to do. And it was, well, you know, he decided pretty much what my life would be and where I would be going. And then at that point, when he died, I realized I'd better find out how to hear from God. Because because who else is going to show me what to do with my life? And can I say this? I am still learning after 50 years. Still learning. I don't have all the answers for you this morning. But I want to share with you some of the things that I have learned. Because it's important. I feel it's critically important that we learn how to hear the voice of God. Because I want to please Him and I want to do what's best for Him. But also, I know that it'll be best for my life as well. Remember reading a book and, you know, it stated, here are the 8 ways in which God speaks. I think they're more than that. He's an infinite God. And I'm going to put a number to that this morning because I don't know how He'll speak to you, but I have heard Him and had Him guide me in many different ways over the years. One of the things I also understand is God's given us a brain. And sometimes you just got to make a logical decision. Okay, so let's get that one out the way. Sometimes you just have to say, well, that's not going to work, so we're not going to do that. Okay, and God's given us logic. He didn't intend for us to become mindless in this process. But as He speaks in many different ways, He said His sheep hear His voice. I'm expectant that as a sheep, I will hear Him speak to me. I'm walking close with Him. And there are many different ways. One of my spiritual sons, before we planted him out into a particular city back home, he said he kept on seeing the number plate of that city. He'd be driving around where we live, and he'd see, and it's like God would just focus him on that, on the number plate that came from this particular place. And over, he said it was uncanny how God just kept on focusing him on that. And ultimately the doors opened, and we worked through the whole thing, and we sent him there. And he's doing a great job of pastoring a church now in that city. So there are many ways God does things. But okay, here goes. Number one, if we can put it up. Number one, lesson number one, the Bible is our absolute. You've got to understand that God will not contradict His word. And as a general overall view of what we do, Scripture applies. So the specifics may not be there. Most of what we're looking for are specifics. But in the overall picture, we know thou shalt not commit adultery. So you don't have to ask God about that one. Okay. All right. So God doesn't, you know, he's not going to speak against His word. And so often people hear things which come out of their flesh or from somewhere, and it's not from God. It's against His word, but they do it anyway, saying, you know, we don't have to go into that. I mean, I've had people come to me and tell me that God told them to get divorced. God hates it. God hates those things. Now, life happens, and I know there's grace beyond that, but I can't believe that we can go to the, you know, we can allow the word to give us permission to do things which it very clearly says no to. All right. So what about the specifics? Well, I've tried lots of things in my life. Here was one of the things that happened. When I was at Slit University, I studied medicine, and I remember reading somewhere in the word that you know, man can toss the coin, but it's God who decides which way it falls. And I cannot for the life of me now find where that scripture came from, but I did find in Proverbs where it says, you may have to draw straws when faced with a tough decision. So in this particular translation, I think it was the Good News, and I've looked in so many versions, I couldn't find the exact version that, you know, was tossed the coin. But so you've got a decision like, shall I buy the Mustang Sport or do I get the Hyundai SUV? You know, it's like, okay, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? To a girl it is, yeah. That's why we have wives. Toss the coin and, oh, it's a Hyundai. Maybe we just do best of three, shall we? But I mean, I started out doing that kind of thing because I was young in the Lord, and I was at university. I was studying. I didn't have a regular church I was going to. We used to attend a Methodist church at that stage, but. And there's so many things one has to learn in this thing, and one thing I learned then. Is that that's not a good way, because if the neighbors are misbehaving and he misbehaves enough, you know, and then in the end you've had enough, you say, God, shall I kill him? You know, that's not a good time to flip a coin. All right, so lesson number two. Lesson number two, if we can put it up. We got it? Flipping coins is for soccer games. Okay, if you want to know who's going to play from the left and who's going to play from the right, then flip the coin and decide it on that basis. All right. And I'll tell you why it doesn't work anymore. I don't think drawing straws, which is what they used to do, you'd have a long straw and a short straw. And so in the Hebrew culture, and you draw the straw, whoever got the long straw was the winner. It's Old Testament. The word is clear now. We've got the Holy Spirit in us. Right. So we don't have to do that anymore. The truth is that God will show us by His Spirit. John 16, verse 5, let's just go through that quickly. It's to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, Jesus said, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him to you. I still have many things to say to you, and when the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority. But here it is, whatever He hears, He will speak. Fleeces were something that used to be used in the Old Testament, and I don't want to say to you, don't ever use a fleece, but I'm not sure that that's, you're going to be careful with it. Let me just put it that way. Just be careful with fleeces. I know that it's possible for God to use that, and He does. And Jane and I have on occasion, we've done that. We were at a particular mission hospital. I was working on a particular mission hospital, and we knew somehow, just had the sense that we weren't supposed to stay there and that we were to go to another one. And so one of the fleeces we put out at that stage was, Lord, if they don't ask us to stay, because they knew it was coming to the end of our season there, and if they don't ask us to stay, we'll take that at least as one of the signs that we're not meant to stay here, that it's time to move on. And it was interesting because they were desperate for us to stay, because there was nobody else. We were the doctors in that mission hospital, and they were desperate for us to stay there, but nobody ever asked us to stay, which was very interesting. So for us, that was a fleece at that point that did make a difference. But I want to put up number three here and just say the need does not constitute a call. So the fact that there was nobody there and that we were going to leave them and we were going to go to another mission hospital where there were, in fact, doctors, it had nothing to do with the call. There was a need, but that wasn't the call. The call came from a different situation. And quite miraculously, God spoke to us in that situation, and I don't have time to go into that now, but he does clearly call us and direct us, and it's not always the need that should do that. All right, so then the next one I want to look at is lesson number four, is flipping Bible pages can be dangerous. All right, and I think you probably all know the story because it's been around in the Christian world for so long that guy was flipping through his Bible and then put his finger down and said, and it said there, and he went and hanged himself. So he thought he better flip it some more. They flipped it some more and it said, go and do thou likewise. And so it's dangerous. Let me just say, it's dangerous to flip pages. We have the Holy Spirit now. Now, having said that, very often God will speak very clearly from His Word to us. And I've had many occasions when that has happened. Sometimes, and very, very rarely, it has been when I just put my finger down because I've been desperate in a situation. Don't have time to share all the stories, but just one story I want to share with you this morning. When I was in the medical practice, a friend and I started a medical practice. I was I was a GP, a general practitioner. What do you call them here? A family doctor, whatever. And we started our own practice back at home in Port Elizabeth. And so we were in a situation where we were just starting, and an older doctor came to us and said he was closing his practice, his health was letting him down. He had a lot of bad debt on his books. He wanted to give us the practice, and we realized, it may not have been such a great gift. And so we really needed to hear from God. And God took me to Obadiah. Who reads Obadiah? it was it was the 13th and 14th verses. It says, and here was the interesting thing, because we could have gone into that situation, but this was the scripture God gave me. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Because he was in trouble. And it said, and do not gloat over his disaster. In the day of his calamity, do not loot his wealth in the day of his calamity. And do not stand at the crossroads to cut off his fugitives, and do not hand over his survivors in the day of distress. So, you know, I saw the survivors, not handing over the survivors would mean not handing them over to debt collectors. So, you know, we just backed off the whole thing, and when I look back, it was absolutely the right decision. So sometimes God will do that, but flipping Bible pages can be dangerous. I think it's better to allow the Holy Spirit to direct you to a scripture. And sometimes just as you're reading through the Bible, suddenly, you know, he highlights a particular thing and that speaks to you. All right, lesson number 5. It's the voice of the Holy Spirit we're listening for. That's the lesson that comes out of that. We're not looking for gimmicks. We're allowing the Holy Spirit to direct us and to speak to us. And Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. And so he's directing things. And in 1 John chapter 4, the first letter to John of John, he writes this. He says, you need to test the spirits. So we need to know from which spirit we are hearing in that moment. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already. So we know we can hear from other spiritual sources. And the Antichrist can speak. He can give it to us, and we can make mistakes. How do you test? Well, Paul told us there. If we go on into verse 4, the next slide. Little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are from the world. Therefore, they speak from the world, and the world listens to them. There is a voice in the world that the world receives and listens to. And you know that well in this country. There is a voice that speaks, that it's the Antichrist voice, and it comes in many guises across the world. In Africa, it sounds different. But it's the voice of this world. We are from God. That's what John says here. Whoever knows God listens to us. Whoever is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. There is something, I believe, in the authentic body of Christ where we hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. And there's another voice that speaks that wants us to listen to it. It's the voice that comes from this world. And we know who's behind that. And the father of lies lies. That's how we test him. So lesson number 6 is that those who are from God can help us to discern his voice. Within the body of Christ, we have people around us, we have friends, we have leadership. They can help us to discern what is the voice of God. So sometimes we hear things which are not, you know, they don't sound right. Or people will speak to us or give us advice or something. There's the body of Christ around you. You are from God, John says, and we are from God, therefore there's this interaction in the body of Christ that gives us a safety net, a safety place to talk about the things and to actually, you know, to bounce things off each other so that we will hear. So those who are from God can help us to discern his voice. Proverbs 27 verse 6 says this. It says, wounds from a sincere friend are better than many kisses from an enemy. And sometimes we don't like to hear what our friends are saying, because we want to buy the Porsche, but the friend says, no, get the Hyundai, or whatever. And we don't want to hear that. And often it's our wives who are the ones who can speak very clearly to us. And we don't often, you know, we don't always want to hear what they have to say. And I think we need to be careful to listen to the voice of those who love us, who are around us, friends who are believers, are invaluable. And in the body of Christ, you know, in this very, very special church, you folk need to understand you have a very special church here with very special relationships. The friendships around here are invaluable, and we submit to one another. That's how it works. And that's why God gives us, you know, a wife who has helped me through many, many situations. And I just want to honor Jane, you know, because, yeah, listen to your wife. And drive the Hyundai. All right. let's just get off the motor cars. Shall we just? All right. Okay. Proverbs 15:22. Without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors they succeed. You know, we led our home church back in Port Elizabeth, and it's grown now. We're about 2,500 folk there. But it grew to that not because of any particular skill that I had, but of just because of the team. Because in the council of many, I can't look back, and I can't say it with any pride either, because it was the team. But I don't think we made any serious mistakes in all those years, because I allowed the team to speak, and sometimes my ideas were off the wall and they corrected me, and we never went down that road. So in the council of many, and that's why, you know, having an eldership here, having leadership, it's wonderful. As Rod said, you know, they would turn to us as well in times of need when their decisions and things, we're here with counsel and with wisdom from years of experience, and that brings a security, and we hear God's voice together and can then move forward. Number seven then says this: prophecies may confirm and help to direct us. So that's the next one I want to look at. God speaks through prophecies. Now, again, you have to be careful. As I said, just be careful with fleeces. Be careful with prophecies, because there are many times that someone will bring a prophetic word and they've sucked it out of the air somewhere. Now, Scripture is very clear about that. I don't have time to go into all of that this morning. But we are told not to quench the Holy Spirit. So let's read that Scripture, 1 Thessalonians 5:19. It says, do not quench, this is in the Amplified, do not quench, that is, suppress or subdue the Holy Spirit. Do not spurn the gifts and utterances of the prophets. Do not depreciate prophetic revelations, nor despise inspired instruction or exhortation or warning, but test and prove all things until you can recognize what's good and to that hold fast. Now, presumably because we need to test it, there is a false version. And there is. We know that. And Paul says to us, test these things and hold on to what's good, and the rest of the stuff, you know, spit it out. Spit out the bones, you know, keep the meat. Right. So we know that we are supposed to do that. And there are many, many ways we can be tripped up through this. And it brings us to lesson number eight, and that is this, that the idol can speak to us. And the idol can speak to us through the prophet. And I'll show you that scripture. In fact, let's read it, because people can prophesy through the idol. Ezekiel 14, verse 4. Thus says the Lord God, everyone of the house of Israel who sets up his idols in his heart and puts before him what causes him to stumble into iniquity, and then comes to the prophet, I, the Lord, will answer him who comes according to the multitude of his idols. The New Living Translation, just put that below there, it says, I will give them the kind of answer their great idolatry deserves. That's a scary scripture. What the Lord is saying to us is this: if you continue to hold up the idol as being the most important thing, then I will eventually speak to you through that idol. Lord, I need this new iPad, this one that can do whatever it does in the most amazing way. Oh God, please let me have this. Please, Lord, this will solve all my issues in life. This is the answer to every... Just imagine I'll be able to preach off this, and I'll be able, oh God, this is a wonderful thing. Isn't, Lord, let me just show you, isn't this an incredible thing? And it begins to become, now this can be a wife, a child, a boat, the Ferrari, whatever it is, and a new house, it can be all sorts of things. And as we bow to the idol, what God is saying is, in the end, I will speak to you through that and say, you can have me. And I've walked in this. It's a scary thing to buy something you weren't supposed to. I bought a Range Rover when we were on the mission. It nearly destroyed us financially. And when I look back now, great lessons, but painful lessons, because we need to be sure that it's God speaking and not the idol. God said, I'll answer you. So whatever the idol is that you've raised up in your heart, as I said, a husband, a wife, a baby, a motor car, whatever it is, that thing eventually can speak to you, and God says, okay, I'll speak to you through the idol. And prophecies can be polluted. And it's through number one, idols. The word says, and we don't have time to go into it this morning, but personal inspiration. There are things, somehow, things get put out into the spirit realm, and they are read in the spirit realm and prophesied. It comes out of our hearts and our imaginations. Our own imagination can construct things. And then, of course, there's obviously demonic interference, which directly gets involved in that. So Paul says, test it. How do we test it? Well, you don't just test it on your own, I believe. God's given us people around us to help us to test the prophecy. And just, is this God or is this not God? And then to work it through. And if it's not, put it, you know, fortunately we don't have to stone the prophets anymore. Otherwise we'd be very busy. Okay. Yeah. All right, and I include myself in that as well, because I've operated in the gift of prophecy quite strongly over the years. But I'm comfortable when I know somebody's going to judge it. And then I'll speak what I feel the Lord has said, because that's the way it works in the New Testament. All right, number nine. Lesson number nine. There are three voices we hear in our heads. Okay. Here are the things that you can hear in your head. You can hear your voice. You can hear an evil spirit. Or you can hear the Holy Spirit. Those are the three voices. We know that Satan can drop thoughts into our minds. Now, I don't think he can read your mind. You know, as I look at Scripture, I don't think he can read our thoughts. But he can drop thoughts in. How do we know that it's from him? Well, we said he's the father of lies. So, yeah, whenever it's pretty, you get a bit of experience, you know very quickly when he's dropping thoughts in your mind. Okay, so you can write those off. It's a little more difficult when it's your thoughts. But here's one of the clues, and that is if you have had a logical sequence of thinking, you know, you saw a picture of something and it led you to think about this and that, and you can go back in your mind and say, okay, well, that was triggered by that. That was a logical thought sequence. It may not be evil. It may not be wrong. It just may not be the Holy Spirit. But sometimes you just get this thought about someone, and then you you pray for them and you become concerned for them or whatever it is, and give them a phone call and find out there's something, and it was the Holy Spirit. So that happens, I think, quite often. Most of the times we probably miss those moments because we're so busy with life. But I think that's how it works. So you can only hear from three, your thoughts come from three places. Number one, your own logical thoughts. Number two, evil thoughts from the enemy. Number three, the Holy Spirit drops something into your mind. All right, so number 10, let's keep moving. Journaling helps me to focus. I have found that if I can write down, and I'll often in my quiet time, I'll just write down what I feel the Holy Spirit is saying. Mark Verkler wrote a book years ago on it, and it was just so helpful because I'd been doing it before that and just wondered, you know, the validity of it. And he put the whole theological structure to the thing in his book. But it's helpful because it gets my mind off natural thinking, and I just write down the words as they come, as they flow. Now, afterwards, you go back and you read those things. If there is anything that you're insecure about, then God gives us friends. He gives us leadership. We go to, you know, our pastor or the elders or whoever, friends, good friends who say, I feel like God's telling us to move town. You know, those are big decisions. Or I need to sell the house and do something else. Whatever it is, those things I think we need to just, we need to weigh them carefully with others, all right? I started doing that long before I read, you know, Mark Werkler's stuff, but we were on the mission hospital. And this is where one has to be careful. You know, I remember going into my study, and I would come out and I'd have journaled, you know. And one morning I came out and we had the whole story. I had about where what we were going to do, and I brought it to Jane, and Jane said to herself, "Oh my Lord, I've married Moses." and Moses then took her on a journey from where we were on the mission hospital, right up in KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa, all the way down to the south coast, and we arrived at the place where Moses had said it would be, and it turned out to be a shopping center. And I know this doesn't happen to anybody else, but I was so deflated. I don't know what. God spoken this word to me, but it wasn't God. It was a good thought, you know. Some great ideas. And then, because I didn't have any. We were alone on that mission hospital in many ways. We didn't have many Christian folk around us, and so didn't bounce it off anybody. Didn't test it in anything. And then I came to this conclusion as a result of that, because we went down there and then God took us on a completely different path. And I came to this conclusion, number 11, the tunnel light may not be the destination. So sometimes God says things to you, and that's not, it's just the thing that takes you down the tunnel. And as you're going down the tunnel, you suddenly find halfway down there's another tunnel that goes off to the right, and there's a light down that tunnel, and that is the destination. But where you started from, you couldn't see that light. So sometimes God takes us on a journey which is, it seems like, what's going on? But he's taking you here, and then he moves you to another place. So that light may not be the destination. It may just be a direction on the journey to the destination. And sometimes you've got to start moving. You know, we always say a yacht, a sailing boat, you can't begin to steer it until it starts moving. Sometimes we just got to get going in a direction. So we think we've got to go this way. And then God can steer us once it's starting to move. All right, number 12. Just quickly, you can leave that up, but just quickly, remember when Abraham took Isaac up the mountain? His light at the end of the tunnel was, I'm going to sacrifice Isaac. But when he got there, he found that there was another plan. So it's there are good scriptural back, you know, there's good scriptural backing for that one. All right. Number 12, turn to a team of advisors. I've already spoken about this, but Proverbs 15:22, which we read, said, without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors, they succeed. And in church situations, in wherever it is, there's great wisdom in the counsel of many. So encourage you to remember that. Turn to a team of advisors, and when you don't know what to do, there are other folk around who can help you. Number 13 says, next time may be different. Just because we did it this way this time doesn't mean the same rule applies next time. God's the God of, you know, he's of multiplicity. He's the God of the infinite. Yeah, mysteries. And God can do it. He can do whatever he wants to. He does. My experience is just because it happened this way, next time doesn't mean that it will. So we need to go to him every time. Say, Lord, what is it that you're saying? What do I need to do in this situation? All right. There's a... the way for you is likely to be unique. Let me put it that way. I think because God is so... he's so abundant. I think it's likely to be unique. And so I want to just remind you, as Peter and John were coming off the beach with him, right at the end of John's gospel, and Jesus was speaking to Peter, and John was walking in the background. Jesus was speaking to Peter and said, Peter, do you love me? Remember the story. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Feed my sheep. And then he And then he turns around and he says, and what about him? And he points to John, who's a little bit behind them on the beach. And Jesus said to him, what is that to you? You follow me. And for me, what that says is this. You know, God's got a plan for me. Don't be looking around to see others' plans. And don't, because God spoke to them and said to them this in a particular way, we can't expect he's going to do the same with us. What's that to you? And let them do what they're supposed to do. God, speak to me and help me to know what I'm supposed to do. All right. So, and when I get into the position, lesson number 14, I have to be willing and prepared to go left or right. Sometimes, if you get to the fork in the road, I have to stand there and say, Lord, if you say left, I'll go left. If you say right, I'll go right. Because what otherwise happens is the idol begins to speak to you. I don't want to live in that town. I want to live in this town. And God's saying, actually, I want you in that town. We've experienced that. We live in a place that we really did not want to go to. We just saw the worst side of it at the time we made the decision, but we knew God said go. It's been the best decision of our lives. You know, we've lived wonderfully at peace in that place. So be willing to go left or right. We don't dictate to God in the moment of the decision. Allow him to make the choice. All right, number 15, the last one I want to share with you, is make peace your umpire. If there's anything I leave you with today, this has been the most successful and most sure way that I have found that I'm in the will of God. And this, for us as a local church in our eldership, this is what, in the end, I think caused us not to make any serious mistakes over 18 and a half years that I led the church. We submitted it to this test, Colossians 3:15. It's out of the Amplified. It says, and let the peace, that is, the soul harmony which comes from Christ, rule. Let it act as umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds in that peaceful state to which, as members of Christ's one body, you were also called to live. The peace of the Lord Jesus cannot be counterfeited by Satan. He cannot give you peace. The peace of Jesus, let it be the umpire. Let him say in or out. He's the one who sees, is the ball in or is it out? Allow the peace to settle in your hearts in there. And let him direct you. And that, for me, is an absolute truth. That is, for me, the most important thing. When I'm not at peace, I don't make a decision. And we would just back off. As an eldership, when we didn't have the peace in the together, we just back off until we did find the will of God together. So, is it God? Is it the devil? We go on a mission journey. No. We have a puncture on the way. The tire goes flat. Is that God? Is that the devil? Sometimes it's very difficult to know, isn't it? Is Satan is he trying to stop us, or is God trying to tell us don't go? It's not always clear. All right, I want to give you, just as I close, some help just in a very practical way of deciding, is this God or is it not? And just because it doesn't seem nice doesn't mean it's not God. And just because it does seem nice doesn't mean that it is God. So just with thanks to Bob Mumford, who wrote a book on this, I've added a little to it, but I want to put up the last slide, and I just called it Three Lights and Some Friends. And I want you to see, if you're on that sailing ship down the bottom left and you need to get into the harbor, which is top right, there are three lights. And it's amazing, because a couple of weeks back I was in Durban at the harbor in Port Elizabeth with some folk, and the guy I was with just volunteered this. He said, you see those lights? Says that's what the boats line up when they go into the harbor. So they go through a narrow channel to get into the harbor, and they just line up the lights. And so here are the three lights. We line them up. Number one is Scripture. Said to you, that is the absolute. Scripture's got to be in line. Number two, circumstance. When the circumstances begin to fall in a particular way, You know, I believe God is beginning to speak. So it doesn't mean that circumstances on their own, because I think Satan can pull us into things where circumstance would suggest that we go in this direction and it's not God. That's why I say you've got to have the three lights lined up. Is this within Scripture? Most of the decisions are, you know, moving home, whatever it is, buying whatever it is, getting married. Those things are not in Scripture to tell us. Getting married is a godly principle. The actual wife that you marry, you know, Scripture's not clear about. All right. So then we've got to go to God and hear from Him. Scripture, the circumstances, and then, as I said to you, the one that for me is the absolute, and that's the peace of Christ. Now, I've added a fourth one, and that is, you'll see, it says trusted counsel on the top right. I think you need to put a few friends on the harbor wall and say to them, help me, are my lights lined up? Because you're seeing it from the other direction. Are my lights lined up, and am I okay? Or am I going to smash my boat on the rocks because I didn't get this thing right? And that for me is, you know, those four things, if I can get the three lights and some friends all lined up, I'm pretty sure I'm not going to smash the boat on the rocks and I'm going to get into the harbor safe. You're not sure what to do, just wait on Him. Delay the decision until it's clear. Rather stay where you are until God has shown you clearly. And so this morning, as we maybe just close our eyes together, I want to just give us a moment to dwell on this. Father, we want to thank You that Your Word is one of the lights that will never let us down. We thank You that the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ will never let us down. It will be our umpire always. And thank You that You will put the circumstances together to confirm. And thank You for friends. Thank You for the body of Christ that is around us. If you this morning feel like you need some prayer in that area, I'm going to invite you just to come up front. Maybe just some of the leaders could help us just to pray for folk who have decisions to make. There are always people in the midst of making decisions. Maybe a big decision, it may not be a big one, but I'm very happy to pray for you. If there's no one, that's fine. We'll have some fellowship and some coffee. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Just give it a moment just to
firstly, I just submit myself to You, Lord, and forsake pride and any sort of foolishness. I'm here because I felt like You were speaking to me and my lights were lining up. About 5 months ago, I was in the ship, but the ship was taken on water. It was not upright like this ship behind us. And I may have looked like everything was okay on the outside to most of you, but things were not okay in my mind. And that's probably a story for a different day. But I became so desperate for the voice of God that I said all the other voices need to stop. The Facebooks, the Instagram, the sports, even certain friendships and different things. I had too many voices in this head. I was taking on water from these voices, and the Holy Spirit was speaking to me the whole time, but I couldn't figure out which voice. And I think that's something that our generation has to face, and us as a people, we have to face. The distractions are so many, and they look so good and enticing. But number five on your point was the voice of the Holy Spirit is the one that guides us. The Spirit of truth speaks to our spirit, the truest part of us. Our spirit speaks to our mind, and our mind controls our body. Mm-hmm. That is the way the Creator in His perfect plan set us up.
Mm-hmm.
But so many of us have a wall between our spirit, and our mind. Earlier as we were singing, I felt like everybody in their own ways needed to present this scenario of a wall in between your spirit and your mind, and see a weapon of your choice, or Jesus as the person holding your weapon, and you're just holding the shield for him, like a good armor bearer. Break down that wall. I'm not here to tell you what it looks like. I don't know what your wall is. You don't have to, but Jesus knows. Name that wall with Jesus this week. Name that wall with Jesus and bust it down with the weapon of your choosing, the sword of the Spirit, Thor's hammer if you can wield it, whatever it may be. But as we look at this, I eliminated those voices to the best of my ability, and I begin to soak in his presence. And I started hearing his voice. I got back into scripture, which, not unsurprisingly, I had neglected. I came back to truth. Then circumstances started aligning themselves, and I felt his peace again in a way that I had never known. And around that time, John and Jane were in town, ironically. And these things were lining up, and I met with a trusted counsel right over here, and they prayed for Ashley and I, and we said we've got some business ideas, and we have some things that we'd like to do. And as they were praying for us, he said, I really feel like you need to get a journal and sit down. I feel like there's things the Holy Spirit wants to tell you guys. So for 20 days, we met together every night at our kitchen table. And he told us things we didn't know. Call to us, and I will tell you unsearchable things, things that you do not know. He was true to that promise. So now we have products that we never even had it dreamed of. And one other thing is, ironically, to make this thread tight, we sourced some journals from India, which you started off with. When we received those journals in our hand, there was something that rose up within us that says, we can do this. The stitching was not overly complex. The quality could be improved upon. And so we just submitted ourselves to this. And then over the last 5 months, we began a process of just listening for his voice. And that has brought us, I guess, here to this moment. I was trying to stay back there in the back, but sometimes I think we need examples of how this works in the real world. There's a bunch of truth in this, these things, but 5 months ago, and now 5 months, I made these.
Wow.
They're American made. The cows are American hides. The tannery is from America. And I'm proud of that. But God met me in this process. And as I use my hands, he's there with me. And so that I trust that the peace of God that's in these journals will go and be with you, John and Jane, as you receive these first fruits.
Oh, wow.
That we wanted to give to you today.
Oh, wow. Wow. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Well, we know as we receive first fruits, we hold them up as a wave offering. Pray blessing on the harvest. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We hold up the first fruits and pray blessing, abundant blessing on the harvest. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Yep. Get back into scripture. Yeah.
The key to what Samuel said there was the starting point of scripture. And I really feel the enemy, circumstances, busyness has taken us away from that. I don't care how well you know the scripture, how many years you've been reading. That is always a day by day, moment by moment. That is the pinnacle of everything else. So we have to get back to scripture. That's where it starts in order for you to get to the end.
Hallelujah. Thank you, John. Yay. Yeah. I sense the, as God has promised, that his, it's a year of his fullness. There's some keys that were given to us today. And as we look at February, and we just need to, as Sam and Ashley took time aside and they stopped all the clutter, stopped all this voices, and let's get focused, let's get back on to the main thing. Amen. It's just a wonderful thing, and there's so much, just so rich. Please go to the Facebook, it'll be live, and you guys can listen to it with podcasts, you guys can listen to when you just soak in it, and let's just allow God to unpack and focus us. Musicians, could you come and close with a song with us? Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Guys, put your names down for lunch with us next week. Looking forward to that. And let me, and I ask you to stand. I want to pray for you as we enter this week. And some of you guys are going to do great things this week. Great things. Hallelujah. I'm looking forward to continuing with our series. You have it next week. So come ready. Hallelujah. Father, thank you. As we lift up a song, as we gather, as we close now, Father, we thank you that we know that you never leave us, you never forsake us, that you go with us to lead us beside still waters into pastures green. We thank you for the quickening and the reminder of Holy Spirit that walks with us, and that we would hear your voice much more clearly. Let us be disciplined to unclutter our lives as we set ourselves aside in fast and prayer, that we may hear you clearly, Lord. And we thank you that our steps are ordered by you, and you delight in them, and that we bring joy and great glory to your kingdom this week. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you, musicians. Appreciate that, Amber.